Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Starfist, Book 4, Blood Contact, by David Sherman and Dan Cragg. Read for you by John Bedford Lloyd. Hasilwa Apvane lounged in his workstation in the dimly lit control room, keeping an eye on the bank of screens that nearly surrounded him. His screens and those at four other workstations, glowing with real-time images that ranged the spectrum from gamma to radio, provided the room's only illumination. Only two of the sites in the normally crowded control center were occupied. Everyone else, other than the few people needed to maintain the systems, was at the holiday gala hosted by Dr. Nicholas Morgan. As administrative chief of the exploratory mission to Society 437, Morgan was the de facto head of state. The 846 scientists and technicians at Central, the main scientific station on Wagon, which is what everybody but Morgan called the planet, had other ideas about who was in charge. The 100-odd scientists and technicians of the off-site exploratory mission counted themselves lucky that they were posted to Aquarius or Frosty stations and didn't have to put up with Chief Morgan. Suddenly, Apvane sat upright and stared intently at a corner of one of the screens he was monitoring. "Do we have a supply run coming in?" he asked. When he didn't get an answer, he shot a glance at Suzrain Hirsute, the climatologist at the other workstation. He saw the shimmer of a privacy barrier around Hirsute, and so activated the intercom inside Hirsute's workstation and repeated his question. "Not that I know of," Hirsute replied absently. "Why?" He didn't look up from the atmospheric data he was monitoring. "Someone just dropped into orbit, that's why." A surveillance technician, Apvane was responsible for geological data via satellite gathering sensors. Hirsute looked up at Apvane and blinked rapidly. "No one's due for 2 months, are you sure?" "Of course I'm sure," Apvane snapped. "Look!" He pointed an accusing finger at the radar scope. The climatologist levered himself out of his chair and joined Apvane to look over his shoulder at the radar scope. Clearly visible just above the horizon was a blip against the black of space. "Are you sure that's not one of the other satellites?" Hirsute asked. Apvane tapped the screen. "It's at a higher altitude than our satellites, and it's too big. It's a starship, not a satellite." "Who is it?" Apvane shook his head and reached for his comm unit. He was going to give Morgan a piece of his mind for not alerting him to the arrival of an unscheduled ship. "What was that?" Hirsute asked. "What was what?" Apvane looked back at the scope. "There was a blip right here." Hirsute touched the screen. Numbers were vanishing from the screen where he pointed. "It suddenly appeared, moved a short distance, then vanished." "Impossible," Apvane said. Hirsute was pointing well below the altitude of the satellites, but as Apvane looked, a blip appeared and vanished in a different spot, much closer to Central Station. "What the?" Apvane leaned forward, as though getting closer to the screen would give him more data. "That starship just dropped a shuttle on course to land at Aquarius Station. Why would a starship drop someone on Aquarius instead of coming to Central first?" Hirsute thought about it for a moment. He swallowed and croaked. "Pirates. Only pirates would go to an outstation instead of landing at the main settlement. Oh, hell." Apvane snatched up his comm unit and frantically tapped out Chief Morgan's code. Before he finished, another blip appeared, far too close to be the same object headed for Aquarius Station. "It's landing here!"
"But they haven't signaled us."
Apvane scrambled at his console controls. He brought up the visual from the surveillance camera outside the control center, just as something struck it and the picture dissolved into static. Frantic, he fumbled with his comm unit and tapped in Chief Morgan's code.
"Chief," he said when his call was answered, "I think we've got trouble. Looks like there's a starship in orbit. A shuttle is headed toward Aquarius and someone just landed here."
His jaw clenched as he listened to Morgan's reply.
"I'm not playing some kind of practical joke," he snapped. "They just came in out of nowhere. No signals, no nothing. Someone is here. They might be pirates."
Suddenly, the starship in orbit just disappeared from the screen, and the satellites registered a huge explosion. As Apvane was explaining that the starship appeared to have been destroyed, the door to the control center slammed open, and the two men jerked their attention to it. Hirsute's scream was cut short, becoming a gurgle as he collapsed. Cameron stared disconsolately into the small fire. Things had not been going well for him, not at all, since the group's arrival on Society 437 6 months ago. Opposite the fire, snuggled against the cave wall, Minerva stirred in her sleep. Her blonde hair, once so beautiful, was matted and dirty, as shaggy as the men's. She stank, too. They all did. None of them had spent much time on personal hygiene for months, but she was the only one of the surviving pirates Cameron could trust. The cave they were hiding in extended for uncounted kilometers under the mountains. They only used the first 100 meters or so of the tunnel system that led into the caverns, but they had explored extensively behind the entrance and were satisfied that the place might provide refuge if... Cameron didn't want to think about what if. He was sure their puny defensive measures would amount to nothing if those things did come after them in there. But he'd been careful not to share his thoughts with the others, for fear the tenuous grip he had on them would snap. From the shadows farther inside the cave, someone was pissing. Cameron could just make out Rise Appback, leaning against the wall back there. "Rise," he shouted. "We have to live in here." "I'm not going outside at night, Georgie boy," Rise answered, shaking himself off. "Not with them things out there, no siree." Rise rearranged his clothes. "Thanks to you, Georgie boy," he added sourly. "You'd have been dead 6 months ago with the others if it hadn't been for me," Cameron replied in a tired voice. He was referring to Captain Scanlon and the 100 other members of the Red 35 crew, as the pirate gang had called itself. The surviving pirates blamed him for everything. True enough, it had been Cameron's idea to raid Society 437, but who could have imagined that those things... Cameron shook his head and got to his feet. Carefully, he negotiated his way up the steep tunnel through the sleeping figures littered around tiny fires. At the cave entrance, two men armed with the group's last functional plasma weapons, ancient relics even when Cameron was born, kept fitful watch. They crouched behind a barricade of small boulders, scanning the rock-strewn slope below. "Lowboy, I'm going outside," Cameron whispered to one of the watching men. Lowboy stared at Cameron's back as he clambered over the chest-high barricade of rocks that blocked the cave's entrance. Too high and steep, they hoped, for one of those things to get over, but just negotiable enough for a man. Lowboy wanted very much to burn a hole through Cameron. Sure, he was the leader, but only by default. No, they had to conserve the energy packs, and besides, those things might sense the energy release and come to investigate. Lowboy sincerely hated Cameron, if that was his real name. Nobody in the Red 35 crew ever went by his real name. He'd showed up at their headquarters a year ago, breathing hatred and vowing damnation upon the entire Confederation of Worlds, saying he wanted to join their band, offer them his services. Educated fop, that's what he was, Lowboy reflected. Not real pirate material. But Scanlon had accepted him into the crew. Now look what that's got us, Lowboy thought bitterly. Outside, Cameron stood bathed in the moonlight as he urinated down the slope. They were nearly 1,000 meters above the swamp, and the mountains rose another 1,000 meters behind them. Those things didn't like the elevations, and they liked to stay near water. The only problem, living up there, was fuel and food. There was food at Aquarius Station, about 30 kilometers to the north of the mountain range, and the indigenous amphibians that inhabited the swamps were edible when they could be caught and killed. But leaving the mountains was very dangerous. The others were frightened. They would be content just to remain in the cave until they starved. Cameron put himself back into the rags that passed for his trousers. He cinched the belt at his waist as tightly as he could. He'd lost at least 30 pounds since they came here, and he was conscious now of wearing the same clothes he'd worn when they landed at Aquarius. Well, who brings a change of clothes on a pirate raid, he thought. They were only supposed to stay a few hours anyway. There would be fresh clothes at Aquarius if he could get the others to go there with him. They'd fled the place in such a panic 6 months earlier.
that nobody thought to grab anything useful, much less replacement garments. In their wild desperation to get as far away from those things as they could, none of them thought he'd live 6 months anyway. Jesus, how come nobody knew those things were here in the first place? He wondered for the nth time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.